No, I so please do. So I do write. I do have kids, and Parentis is something is a nonprofit that I founded. Parentis, the mission of Parentis is to keep writers creative after they start a family, so that every writer that we present on the Parentis stage is a writer who has kids. They are all successful writers who have kids. And we want them to be an inspiration for you, and for you. We want this to be inspiring. When I was in graduate school, it was really hard to even consider having a child because there was a sort of, stereotype that if you had a kid, you ruined your career. And I think that that is still current in a lot of industries, and I think in the arts, it is a very big problem. I think that nobody is told, oh, that person who won the Nobel Prize also happens to have kids. And if you want to know the statistics, in the last 10 years of Nobel Prize, 8 of them had kids. So, yeah, exactly, I don't know how to do it. But we're trying to find out, and that's kind of another purpose for having these salons is to a little bit try to find out, like, how do people balance? How do they find time to write? Where do they find the energy to write? And you know, what do they do about money? Since writing is something that's so infrequent, you never know when you're going to get paid. If you're going to get paid, one of the genre magazines that everybody really, really was passionate about just went under, and it was because one writer said, they never paid me. And then all these other writers started coming out and saying, oh, really? I thought it was just me. They didn't pay me either. Chizzy. So there's like all kinds of scandals in the world, and we try to navigate them as best we can, but we also have to go to UC College. So. so here we are. And we have, our regular salon, but we also have a special thing tonight. Tonight we are going to actually be presenting the Pen Parentis Fellowship to our new fellow. The Pen Parentis Fellowship is awarded to a single writer who, through the merit of her work or his work alone, or their work alone, they get a prize for writing beautifully. We completely blind judge it. We strip it of every possible conceivable identifying feature. And we judge solely on the basis of the actual writing. So tonight, we are going to be presenting that award to our newest fellow. And the cool thing that I think is super cool is that the person who is going to be actually handing her the award is our very first fellow that we ever had in 2010. Do we want to do that later? Yes, we want to read first.
Do it now.
Right. So what else did I say? So we have also, in addition to the salons, which are every month, on the second Tuesday of the month, you're all welcome to come back here, and we have a new panel of fabulous writers who are parents, and different themes, and different kind of genres. We also have Friday meetups in Lower Manhattan, which are in person at 10 a.m., and that's findable on the Facebook page, and then there is also on Tuesdays, and we are really adding to this group, we have a meetup as well in Brooklyn, and that is at the main branch of the Brooklyn Public Library, just in the cafe, just outside of the cafe. So they meet there on Tuesdays at noon. And we're looking for new people, so if you're out there in the land of the internet and you need some accountability, that's what we do at the meetups. So let's see, what else do I have to say? I can say that donations in any amount are very welcome anytime. We are a 501c3, so we are very, very delighted that our beautiful food, then wine, was donated this month by Sergio Troncoso, who is an outstanding writer, essayist, and he has a new book out. And so we thank him very much for his generous donation to our wine food. So if any of you, or you, so if any of you would like to sponsor December Salon, come talk to me, because I can arrange that. If you are looking to get involved in any other way, we also welcome you, so come and talk to me if you want to get involved. And I want to thank LMHQ because the space is very cool. This is a co-working space that is run by the Downtown Alliance. It does have really cool programs in addition to ours, which everybody is welcome to come to. There are also these really neat things in the mornings for women, media women mostly, and it is just, they're called Women's Networking Breakfasts, and they're, I think they're once a month. They're very neat. And that's a LMHQ event. LMHQ stands for Lower Manhattan Headquarters, in case anybody was wondering. And what else? We just did a great panel in Baltimore at the City Lit Festival, which was on the stage of, it was on the City Lit stage at the Brilliant Baltimore Festival, sorry. And that was very amazing. And Christina organized that. And then we also did a Women's Catalyst event in Industry City in Brooklyn, which was very exciting. Yeah, that's enough talking. So now it's time to introduce Christina, who is awesome, and she's our curator. And she has a new book coming out in May called Beauty, so you shall buy it.
Hello. So the theme this month is Small Towns USA. And part of what's interesting about this theme, I think, well, there are several things that are interesting. You know, after the election, everyone's like, oh, small towns, you know, like, we always forget about the small towns. Well, we didn't forget the small towns. And one thing I found really interesting was that with the way we get our authors, we do it by theme. And so the authors didn't actually know who was going to be in this group. And I just found it like, you know, when you think of small towns, you think like, I don't know, I mean, I don't necessarily think that two Asians would end up on the panel. Right? Like, but wow, like then I'm like, whoa, see, like, there you go. That changes things a little bit. Yeah. So I thought that was really, really cool, and I can't wait to hear what these authors read and have to share with us. So our first author is going to be Jimin Han. Jimin was born in Seoul, Korea, and grew up in Providence, Rhode Island, and in Dayton, Ohio, and in Jamestown, New York. So a lot of small towns. She attended Cornell University as an undergraduate, earned an MFA from Sarah Lawrence. Her writing can be found in NPR's Weekend America, Poets and Writers Magazine, The Rumpus, and elsewhere. A Small Revolution, her first novel, was among Entropy's Best Fiction of 2017, Pleiades Editor's Choice 2017, Red Book Magazine's 20 Books by Women You Must Read This Spring, BuzzFeed's 6 Binge-Worthy Literary Books of May, CNN's Summer Beach Reads, and Electric Literature's list of 34 books by women of color to read this year. Oh, and also the list of 10 galvanizing books about political protest. She teaches at the Writing Institute at Sarah Lawrence College and lives outside New York City with her husband and children in the suburbs. Here's Jimin.
Okay. Hi, everybody. Thank you, Christina. Thank you, Melba. It's such an honor to be here. And it's very timely also, we'll talk more about it, because I have, we're going to be empty nesters really soon. So, and it's not a coincidence that my book came out when my older ones graduated from high school. So we'll talk more about all of that. So the novel is A Small Revolution, and while Providence and Dayton are cities, Jamestown was very much a small town in which we moved every 2 years. Within this town. And so when I was writing this novel, I drew from my life. And so the main character also grew up in a small town. So A Small Revolution is written in segmented fiction. So it's in these numbered sections. What you need to know also is the main character is speaking to this young man that she fell in love with. It opens in a dorm where she's being held hostage, so a little warning there, by someone she thought was a friend who had a bit of a break, psychotic break. And he's really upset because their mutual friend, who was her boyfriend, he thinks is still alive and she thinks he died in an accident. So that's the setup of the book. And it 1985. I'm going to jump around a little bit, which is not what I usually do, just to be able to reference some of the small town parts. Okay. Glasses. The sirens, when they come, loop as if they're fading and then growing louder. Are they coming to rescue us or someone else? Stop. Lloyd shouts as if his words are coming out of a body that is itself a gun. Stop. Stop. Whatever you're thinking, stop. I'll make all of you stop. Wait, Lloyd? My friend Lloyd, you would say? What's Lloyd got to do with this? He wouldn't have a gun. He wouldn't do this. I know him. Our Lloyd from Korea? You wouldn't believe it. You'd refuse. And I tell you, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. How to get to your college? What's he doing in your room? I'm trying to tell you. Listen. My life was simple when I was a child. I walked to school with my older sister. I joined after school clubs. I went home and did my homework. Some days, after dinner, my father beat my mother. Not often, but there were days when that happened, and in between were the days it was about to. My mother said, don't trust a man ever. My sister said, don't trust anyone. My father said, no one understands me in this house. You understood me. You understood Lloyd and me. If you were here, in this room, you'd know what to do. What am I forgetting? You said I was good at making lists. To-do lists, to see lists, to make us remember lists, to figure out how we got here lists, to tell you why I could never see you again lists. The phone rings, so they're still in the dorm room. And Lloyd snatches the receiver and holds it up to his ear, but doesn't let it touch his head, as if he thinks the police can send poisonous gas through it. They're fine, unless you do something stupid. Understand? He says. Then he thrusts the phone at me. Tell him I haven't hurt anyone. I speak into the mouthpiece. He hasn't, but hurry. Dayu and Faye join in with their own hurry. Lloyd snatches the phone away, and I can feel his breath on my cheek as he holds the phone between us. Shut up, or else I'll fucking teep your mouths, too. A man's voice is on the other end of the phone. He says his name's Detective Sachs. He says, are you okay? And I look to Lloyd, who nods, so I tell them, we're four of us, four girls. It's going to be okay, I promise, Sachs says. How many gunmen did you say? He asks. One. Try to stay calm. We're working on getting you out of there. If he has a list of demands, tell him to write them down, and I'll try to get them for him. Relax, he says. Okay, I'm just going to skip a little bit of this. Okay. Once, in my high school gym, I stepped off the bleachers from the top row, expecting to make my way down as everyone else was doing at the end of a school rally. As soon as my foot found air, I knew something was wrong. Instead of finding a foothold on the level below me, I was falling, and I told myself, I'm falling. I must have time because I'm aware of this, and here is air around me, space and air. I'm falling. I can move my arms. I can put out my hands and brace my fall. So move, I told myself. Move your arms. Get your hands ready. My mind told my hands, my arms, even my legs to adjust, and I was convinced I could still make this happen, even as my shoulders slammed onto the polished wooden basketball. Even as my head followed suit, making contact with the surface, I believed I had a chance to affect the way I landed. Stunned, I couldn't believe how fast the floor had risen to greet me. Hard, unforgivingly hard, and my body ached. What had happened to my chance? I lifted my head. My sister looked down at me from the fifth row, where I'd been moments before, and said, "You fell like a rock." No matter what Lloyd says here now in this room, don't believe the part that he loved me, that I gave him the impression that I loved him. You're the only one I ever loved. I don't know what he means by you being alive or how he could save you by killing us. I wanted to believe him at first. I wanted to believe you had survived, as he had survived. I wish I could believe him now, but he's way planting, and he has guns, and I've pushed him to do this. It's my fault he's enraged, but I couldn't help it. I wanted him to be right about you. Last section. I used to climb out of my window to sit on my roof and watch the car lights go up and down the avenue. Where were they going? Inside my house came sounds of furniture being overturned. I tried once to stop my father's rage by calling the police, but when the patrol cars pulled into our driveway, the furniture was right side up again, and the door was open to reveal a pleasant set of parents, upstanding citizens. They explained it was a misunderstanding, a wayward child, a child on punishment who was playing a prank. I watched the whole thing from the landing on the staircase. The police officers didn't call me down to question me. My father offered them tea, and my mother went to make it. He was careful never to strike her on the face. I went back upstairs, clambered out through my bedroom window, huddled on the roof under the branch of an oak tree. I could picture it, the fall forward on the sloping roof of my old house, and the feel of the sparkly shingles on my head, back, and arms as I rolled down, hit the gutter and the yard. Not high enough to be fatal, but it made me think I should stop fighting. Thank you. So it's called A Small Revolution. My editor came up with the title because I had what I thought was a good title, but she said it was too quiet. You'll hear this when you get your books out there. They want to change the title. I don't know if you have this experience. And it was originally called Leaving the Field of Reeds, because there's a poem referenced in my book with that line, right? So, but it's kind of boring. So A Small Revolution is just about how you have a small revolution, people protesting. And we're seeing this now too. Protesting makes an impact, makes a difference. So it's about that and how this kind of led to, you heard about Koreans protesting so much that they were able to get a president to leave office, all kinds of things there. And all of this was starting traditionally, but a lot of it happened in the 80s.
When you look at some of the choir scenes, with the choir scenes, how does it, what are the scenes that kind of contrast each other that people notice? I mean, obviously people notice because it was like in the 10 best in like 50 places. Oh. So what are some of those scenes that really stand out?
I think what I've heard a lot of people say is writing it in the segmented fiction structure, having it set and open in the room where this young man boy is holding these girls hostage on a college campus, that it cuts back and forth to the summer before when Lloyd and Yuna and Jason were in Korea and they got caught up in the protests. So it sort of, and then it cuts back and forth into what she's thinking about and so in her past. So keeping the lens sort of tight on the room kind of makes you wonder what's going to happen in the room. It was written in a lot of different ways. Structurally, it went chronologically forward, it went backwards, like started in the middle when he was stalking her. You're going to see. But the thing to do is you keep working at it until he finds. And I found the structure because I'd given up on it and I decided I was going to write flash fiction. Some of you might be writing flash fiction, right? And flash nonfiction. And that's something that they do a lot of there. Sort of segmented using the white space.
story haunted me. It came up again. I was going to put it away and write flash fiction. And then here was the voice again. So.
And how long did this take to write?
So it took a long time because, you know what, I'm 53 years old. And I'm happy to tell all of you that. I'm happy to tell you that because in my case, it allowed me to be in Poets and Writers 5 over 50. So there works. You're kind of unusual. They don't know that there's so many of us out there. So as a novel, I've had other stories and little things published, but it was the first time that I made a novel. So it took a long time. I put it away. I took it out again when my younger daughter was 2 because she's such a good baby. She went with me to writers' groups. She would come with me to meetings and just sit and look at everybody. And so my first one wasn't like that. You get this, you know, it's kind of like karma. You get one that's good and one that's
So, Marie, you took a while working on this book as well. Yes.
It said it's 15th year.
Oh. Any of you feeling discouraged?
15
years. How about you, Keetje?
I think poems maybe it works a little bit differently. You can be sneaky and be working on a poem and not even know you're working on a poem, and then all of a sudden you have a poem. It started on the back of a napkin and it became something real. And then you think, oh, I didn't do a lot of writing these last couple of years. And then you look at all those napkins. This is, you know, the napkins of like 4 or 5 years. But I have a dirty secret that I'm trying to. And I've been working on it for 3 years, and I think like, you know, let's talk in 10 or 15. Like, I feel very comfortable with that because I have a young child. My wife is pregnant with our second right now. I don't know, but I've heard enough people say it takes its own time. So.
Okay, so we're gonna move on, and then we're gonna come back to questions afterwards. So
after the
Exactly. And then we can open it up for the audience as well. So, Keetje Kuippers is the author of 3 books of poetry, All Its Charms, The Keys to the Jail, and The Beautiful Mouth. Her work has appeared in publications as the New York Times Magazine and has been included in both the Pushcart Prize and Best American Poetry Anthologies. She's read on NPR's Writer's Almanac, that's kind of cool, and honored with a Waller-Stegner Fellowship. I always wondered about that. Okay, we're going to talk about that. Breadloaf's Fellowship and the Marjorie Brown Davis Bowdoin Wilderness Writing Residency. Kuippers teaches at Hugo House and is a senior editor at Poetry Northwest. She lives with her wife and daughter on an island in the Salish Sea where they are the one island on the earth. Everyone,
at the small town drag show, watching Daisy Pukes take the dollar bill between her teeth, shake her fake tits in each boy's peach fuzz face, I recall my once praised body as it comes alive again. Long forgotten cat, now raised from its shallow backyard grave. Cat with sweat on its fur. Cat that nightly screamed below the kitchen's glass. Cat whose backbend stretch of joy raised her pink pinhole to the sky. Daisy's high heel boots scuffed the floorboards. Her nylon blend lashes flutter under fluorescence, and I feel a tingle somewhere, my knees, my tongue, as I pour my sex, its proud performance, back into this dress I've worn like a shroud. So there are, I was writing this book when I was pregnant with my daughter and in the first couple years of her life, when she was 1, 2, and 3. And so there are a lot of poems in this book that have a baby in them, the baby this, the baby that. But it's not really a book about a baby. In my second book, there are a lot of poems that have a dog in them, but it's also not a book about having a dog. So the baby, I discovered in writing these poems, because when I was writing them, I thought, you know, who's gonna want to read this book of poems? Like, white lady mom? That what could be less interesting? Right? Like, what could be less exciting? And then I realized, luckily, that yeah, that that's not what these poems are about. The baby is the way of writing about everything else. Getting the baby to sleep. Sometimes the baby can't reconcile the self with the self. Too hungry to eat, too tired to sleep. I know the feeling. Oh, America, on those nights when you're too beautiful for me to continue to forgive you any longer, for allowing us to kill each other with your graceless bullets, or exile our neighbors across the fences of your fictitious border, or argue over the ownership of each young girl's body as if its freedom is a lie she must stop telling herself. Then, America, I go out into your radiant arms. The baby and I drive through your streets, over the bridge and its light-chipped waters, under a moon so big, so full of itself, that though I know it belongs to the world, it can't be anything but American. I hang my arm out the window and skim the air like touching skin. I breathe you in. And the baby sleeps. And my parents are high school sweethearts from a little town in Michigan, on Lake Michigan. And when my mom was growing up there, she, in the summers, would pump gas and serve fried chicken to the wealthy Chicago tourists who would come to vacation on the lake. And she always said that someday she would go back to that little town and she would stay on the lake. So we did that last year. The Great Lakes. My wife. The one I thought I'd never have. Because does any of us believe we deserve to be happy in this life? Let's my daughter paint her toenails a sloppy silver as my aunt smokes a second cigarette and pages through photos on her phone, so I can see how the car looked after my cousin wrecked it last month in a past midnight field near the poultry processing plant, just a half mile from Grandma's unsold house. High on meth or heroin, or maybe not high at all, but fighting her hunger, while I pick through this dead girl's jewelry just to starve for something to hold on to as those feckless gulls pecking the sand a few feet away. The sun is shining brighter than the gold-plated necklace I fasten around my neck and swear to wear forever. And even though scientists are finding nicotine in the water and oxy in the mussels, my cousin's kids are down there at the edge of the beach screaming their heads off with the pure joy of plunging below the surface. It's hard not to feel good watching the waves. But my aunt needs me to believe in the glass and the blood and her daughter's body, a thing unidentifiable, a thing none of us have really seen in years. She needs me to understand that her pain is water as far as the eye. So we live now on an island, just a short ferry ride away from Seattle. And it's a really, we've been there for a couple of years, my wife and daughter and I, and it's a charming, sweet, lovely, idyllic, semi-rural place. And in the fall, especially in October, it's like every weekend, there's pumpkin mist, cinnamon mat, apple orchard, everything. It's just, it's lovely and charming. And one of the things that they do, the city does a haunted hayride in the local public park. And it's not scary at all unless you're four, which is how old my daughter was when we first moved to the island. And while on this hayride, my daughter Nella was a little scared of this sweet hayride. But it was a strange time. We'd only moved to the island a couple months earlier, and we didn't realize yet what a small community it was, and in the way that everything that happens in that community really touches everyone who lives there. On the haunted hayride with Audrey, who, by the way, is dead, who hanged herself in the neighbor's woods last week, just in time for Halloween, whose lank green hair I know only from the missing signs posted on telephone poles, now rain-logged and peeling in ragged strips of zombie bandages. We should be here tonight, not as a ghost, but as a teenager, like these other 10 dressed in scarecrow rags who blank-faced writhe to the latest pop hit, spooking my own small daughter. It's all right, I tell her, toe-headed hidden in hay bales. Just teenagers. Audrey, I don't have to be your mother to be furious with you. When a specter ziplines across the field, gown aglow with battery-operated ectoplasm, my child lifts her eyes and gasps, "They forgot the angel wings, Mommy." So that I'm gonna stand up and yell, "Audrey, get down from there this minute. Stop scaring me. I'm just going to read one more poem, the one happy poem in the book. We lived for 4 years in Alabama. My daughter will forever have Opelika, Alabama on her birth certificate. And it was a wonderful place to have that baby and to get to fall in love with. We drive home from the lake, sand in our shoes. The dart of fish faint at our ankles. Each shuttered barbecue shack a kudzu flash in my side mirror. Pleasure has become the itch of a mosquito bite between my shoulders, and your rough thumb on my thigh, a tickle gentle as turtles bobbing in sea-dew oil slick and cellophane scrap. How many years did I suffer the loves that gave too much freedom and not enough tenderness? Let me be like that man we saw outside of Natasalda, hands cuffed behind his back, and you be the sheriff, leaning in close, cupping the sweet flame to my waiting.
Society, and you meet all these different raptors in the dark in little tents in this park, and there's this vulture, this turkey vulture, and I started this turkey vulture poem, and I got it like on the back of, you know, a brown paper shopping bag that I found in the backseat of the car after the walk, and I was like, yes, this is good. And then I lost the brown paper bag in a while, like I probably put some groceries in it or something, and then by the time I got back to it, like, it was dead, you know? I couldn't make it. Like, its magic was gone. I remembered what it was about. I remembered what I wanted to say, but the magic was gone. So I think sometimes I'll start a poem in my head, and as long as I don't start writing it down on a napkin or a brown paper bag, then I can sit with it for months or even years and keep the magic. And once I start writing it down, I sort of I have to, yeah, I have to either enter it in that moment or get far enough into it that when I come back, the magic is still there.
Wow.
Yeah.
But the process is so is it different with
which way to say it's completely surprising. Yeah. It's like if you don't write it down when it's in heaven, it just that kind of goes away. Like the writing does not mean that process, at least for me.
And in my head, it seems really good.
Yeah,
and
yeah,
when I go
exactly.
to write it down, it's terrible. That's probably my but I think I think it's true what you say about sort of in that moment of that's the moment you write it.
So, how did you decide? I mean, we have all these different themes, right? How did this resonate with you guys?
Oh, I've lived in so many small towns, and my parents are from a small town. I grew up in many small towns. I think my daughter's idea of the world has been shaped by small towns so far in her life. And even though I used to live in New York and I used to live in San Francisco, so I've also lived in big cities, I feel like it's the small towns that have not only shaped me, but have shaped my writing as well. Like there's a way in which I'm able to pay more attention when I'm in those places and see, like when I'm in, like being in New York this week, there's so much strangeness all around me all the time that I'm inspired by too much, like that I want to write it all down. Whereas in the small town, there's like five strange people and I get time, like it's good to spend time with each of them and write about five strange things that happen each year. And so, yeah, I'm not overwhelmed by material.
How about you guys? How did you guys decide that this would work for you?
I think growing up in a small town now is becoming sort of almost a thing that's becoming extinct. Because now so many towns become part of like a larger like urban, like suburban thing. And since I grew up in northern Minnesota and seeing how sort of unique it was to be in a place that was completely isolated, and then also Bob Dylan also grew up in my hometown. So just, you can have someone with black hair and get completely alienated. And so part of it was interesting because I'm still really good friends with, you know, we're actually getting together in a couple of weeks with my friends who went to high school, but they all had babies and no one went to college, and that was just a normal thing. And so in this, you know, I feel like my world has gotten so much more homogenous, like I'm gonna be friends with someone like that now. But that's someone from this part of me that, you know, was such an important, you know, time in my life. Mm-hmm. And that part of it being in the small town where exactly there's no place to go, we would actually run out of gas. Like we had one block like downtown, we would actually run out of gas for anything. Just
go ahead.
Down pavement. Because there's nothing to do. But it was kind of this weird, you know, like hermetic ceiling, especially if you didn't have internet, and it was just kind of and I still get my hometown paper just because I'm kind of curious and who is the front pages. First Robin of Spring was seen. You know what I mean? Like it's not the New York Times where this chemical thing is blown up or who's Trump. It's the first Robin of Spring, and then it's also like, you know, there's meth is a big problem. it's just so different than it's almost like a fantasy land now for me to see that. It's so different.
And I think of Jamestown even though I get in the other places just because those 10 formative years, but I love that poem you just read about going and what you said about your mom going back to like Michigan. And so last summer I got to go to Chautauqua to be a writer in residence, which is right near Jamestown.
Oh,
you've been there, right? And that was kind of my dream because Jamestown is a small, it's really a small town with a whole bunch of small towns all around it with this arts mecca. And to grow up in this sort of working class place and go get to sing in the all county choir and some tenor in this place was so magical. And so to be able to go back to that. But the thing I wanted, when you said small towns, Christina, which means so for all this, we live in a small town now in
social media, you get to hear about them all, unlike 20 years ago. It's really wonderful. I think for a writer, it's great.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going to move on to Marie, and then we'll open it up for the discussion. Okay, so every once in a while in life, you meet someone who really makes a huge difference in your life. And I would say that Marie Lee is one of these people for me. She probably is this, like this with many people, but I have been really, really lucky to be one of them. So, Marie. Marie Lee, Myung-Ok Lee, is an acclaimed Korean American writer. Her novel, you don't have it here.
The Evening Hero is the new title.
Yes. So she's working on a novel called The Evening Hero. Thank you. She didn't put that in her. And it's about the future of medicine, immigration, and North Korea. And it's forthcoming from Simon & Schuster. She graduated from Brown University, teaches at Columbia University's writing division. Her stories and essays have been published in The Atlantic, The New York Times, Slate, Salon, Guernica, The Guardian, and many, many, many others. She was the first Fulbright scholar to Korea in creative writing, and she received many honors for her work, including an O. Henry Honorable Mention, the Best Book Award from the Friends of America Writers, and Rhode Island State Council of the Arts Fiction Fellowship, and is currently, aren't you a New York Foundation for the Arts Fiction Fellow. She got that. She is also a Yaddo McDowell Colony Fellow, so if you have any questions about that, she would be the person to speak to. She's served as a judge for the National Book Award, and in addition, she is one of the co-founders of the Asian American Writers Workshop. Everyone, Marie Lee.
Christina, and I will note that she is one of the other co-founders of the Asian American Writers Workshop. So we have been friends for very long.
Yeah, it's modest.
So,
30
years.
I really want to thank Christina and Milda, my wonderful co-readers, and Parentis, because this is really, I just always love coming because it's good conversation, I love being in the audience. It's just like a really wonderful sort of resource to have. So I'm really, really happy to be here, and I love this theme. So I am going to read an excerpt from my forever novel, The Evening Hero, which is still in progress, and I hope it will be coming out sometime in 2021. It actually has been under contract since 2012, that there had some editing things, and actually the election changed a lot of things. I decided satire was dead after 2016, so that was a big problem. And it's set in a fictional northern Minnesota town on the eve of an involuntary hospital closure. And Jimin and I are also friends. I have to apologize because she's one of the people who's been reading the novel and helping me with it. So I hope you're not super bored.
No, I love it. So, that's great.
And again, it's called The Evening Hero. So his name is Youngman. The components of his name were, as custom dictated, selected by his paternal grandfather, his Harabuji. The grounding character, Young, Evening, cemented him to all his cousins, Young Jo, Young Po, Young Chan, Young Go, in the 12th generation of Kwaks, whether he knew them or not. Man meant hero. To his patients, now his former patients, he was no evening hero, but Dr. Kwok, a little Asian man, certainly short of stature at 5'4", the hospital's obstetrician. He was distinctive to the white townspeople, not just for being Asian, but for being the first doctor from somewhere, anywhere else. First, North Korea, then South Korea. In America, a year first in Birmingham, foreign trained physician had to prove competency. He was a graduate of the Harvard of Korea, but hospitals in cities from Los Angeles to Cincinnati didn't even bother to reply to his letters. Youngman would end up so desperate as to drive straight north with his wife and infant child to this Arctic Circle of the US, the Iron Range of Minnesota, where schools closed for blizzards only when temperatures fell below minus 50 degrees. A perfect fit, his desperation matched only by the desperation of Horses Breath General Hospitals, the
Not him exactly, but the job at OBGYN had gone unfilled for years. For generations, almost everyone who lived and worked in horse's breath descended from the Scandinavians brought over by the mine owners in the 1900s. Their children became the next miners, but also teachers, storekeepers, pharmacists, janitors, and doctors on down the line. The social roots, with nowhere to go, growing more Gordian, inward, inviolable, ever more unparsable to the non-generational horse's breather. The townspeople needed an outside physician to deliver their babies. Beggars can't be choosers. The inconvenience of young man's statelessness could be politely ignored, like a visible disfigurement, unless it was a problem. Horse's breath, named because the settlers could only see if the horses were still alive that first winter by checking for their breath, was so insular, a person from Applesgate, 7 miles over, where the taconite processing plants were, was considered a stranger. Movement between towns, even for marriage, was rare. And yet, the Finns, Swedes, Norwegians, and later Slovaks, Slovenians, Serbs, Croats, Poles, an Italian or two, and admixtures thereof, were all lily white, and yet incurious of the ochre-toned Dr. Kwok, his Korean wife, Young-e, and his Korean-ish son, Einstein. Was it because the Kwoks were outsiders and unlikely ever to become insiders? Or was it horses, breeders, or merely being typical Americans, requiring but a line or two of biography to believe they satisfactorily knew the whole story? Learn to drive, go back to China, Ching, was what Young Man heard on his first day of work as he nosed his car, shined up just for the occasion, into the hospital's parking lot. The man gave him a finger, which to Koreans was just pointing, and drove off, the smoke from the twin exhaust of his pickup truck flaring like contrail. During his 3-week voyage to America, Young Man came to learn that Americans would presume he spoke no English, despite the fact he was quite fluent. They would also pronounce his name wrong, his young man, instead of Young Man. On the ship, it had been difficult to know if he or some young porter was being addressed. Yoo-hoo, young man! And so by the time he entered the country at the port of San Francisco, he stepped through another portal and chose a brand new name, William. Will I am. He liked that. Changing one's surname was also something immigrants often did to make themselves seem less ethnic. He would never think of doing that, and neither did Lee Iacocca, whom he admired. Young Kwok sounded exactly like the call to prayer at the Buddhist monastery where he and Yongshik had lived as children. The sunim, every morning at 3 a.m., striking the wooden gong with a tiny wooden bat that started at heartbeat pace and proceeded in syncopation to a rapid staccato. At the end, quack, 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 resonating oddly pleasantly inside his skull. Stan Nitzer, the surgeon and the impressionable big shot of the hospital, after being introduced to Young Man, said, "Hey, Dr. Quack," like a duck, and thought it was quite funny. And accordingly, some of the nurses and the anesthesiologists laughed along. Young Man didn't even know what a quack doctor was until someone explained it was like being called a torn potty surgeon. Is a pseudo-doctor. Didn't they know that a man's family name, there were 10,000 years of Kwoks in the family book, was not something being made light of? Dr. William Kwok was thus invisible, except when he wasn't. In his medical practice, he took long and careful histories of his patients. He reviewed these notes prior to each visit. When he saw them, he could ask his patients after it hit their relatives, even their pets. Dr. Kwok, do you have a family, one little child, a sibling, asked during postpartum rounding for Young Man to see how the newborn was doing? It was such a rare thing for someone to ask him a personal question. Young Man almost wept with gratitude, wanted to shake the 8-year-old's hand. Adult questions, when they occurred, were so much more pointed. I thought all Koreans were Park Kim and Lee after the 1988 Olympics. Are you and your family Muslim? After 9/11. How do we know you ain't a North Korean spy? It made Young Man realize that Korea in general so rarely ever surfaced in the consciousness of the American people, except as a war. Early on in Young Man's tenure at Horse's Breath, while waiting for his pregnant patient, Mrs. Solbach, to to return from the lavatory during an office visit. Slightly irked, she had respected his and his patient's time by going before the appointment. The husband, occupying the rickety second-class chair reserved for husbands, grinned at young man through his awkward silence. Then he pulled off his steel-toed work boot, peeled off his red-top thermal sock, right in the office. Young man wanted to discuss the illogic of having the town OBGYN look at a male's foot when the man's thrust forward a hairy appendage, paw-like in its shape, with the two end phalanges missing. Diabetic necrosis? Frostbite while sitting too long in a duck blind? Ice fishing? Fought in the chosen reservoir, the man said. Middle of winter. They called our battalion the chosen frozen. Our rubber-bottomed shoe packs were so cheap, our feet would sweat when we marched, freezing we stopped. And they were slipperier than hell on those slopes. Guys would take them off, feet would swell, and they'd be walking around on bleeding stumps later in the day. Young man did not know if this man was expecting gratitude. He tried to imagine Solvang as a big-eared lad of 18 or 19, shipped from his home in the tiny mining town of Horses Breath, Minnesota, all the way across the Pacific to Korea to fight a war he didn't really care about or understand. Young man would have liked to have said something about how at the turn of the 20th century, Japan invaded Korea, declared the world the newest imperial Japanese colony, one where Koreans' customs, their holidays, their own language, down to their names, would be outlawed. The Koreans looked to the big brother countries like America to help them against this terrible act against their sovereignty, not knowing that Roosevelt had, earlier, sent his war chief to Tokyo negotiating an agreement that in return for Japan allowing the U.S. to move its military into the Philippines unopposed, the U.S. would in turn ignore Japan's invasion of Korea. As geopolitics happened, or World War II, Japan was now an enemy. The U.S. dropped two nuclear bombs. One would have easily been sufficient, but Pearl Harbor. Japan surrendered. Koreans rejoiced. Of the young Korean girls who'd been shipped to the front as sex slaves for the Japanese soldiers, these survivors began the long trek back to Korea on foot. This is what young man would have liked to say to Mr. Solvang. The Korean people are always a step away from disaster, but a footnote to history. What other culture would have as a proverb, as love grows, next a separation happens? Returning the peninsula back to the people seemed like the right thing to do. The Americans, however, decided Korea would be Solomonically split at the 30th parallel, the northern piece handed over to the Soviets, the southern to the US, inscribing on Korea's peninsula the same way the Japanese soldiers entertained themselves by carving the rising sun on the bodies of the teen Korean girls, the global Cold War. Stalin imposed communist rule via a titular head, Kim Il-sung. In the south, the U.S. Army in Korea established itself as an occupying force. Communism is cholera, and you cannot compromise with cholera. This was Reed, the newly installed president. As he said it, not elegantly, but most importantly, in English, the official language of this new occupation. The decrees and rules all went out in English, which most people didn't understand. And for Reed, communism could be a handy brush to paint any opposition. The U.S. carefully appeared not to notice as all of Reed's political opponents, along with their vice presidential candidates, were mysteriously assassinated on the eve of the presidential election. There were protests. The communist agitators often disappeared, including Young Man's father, an agronomist, who had helped organize the 3-1 independence from Japan movement. Young Man's father was last seen being dragged off along with his colleagues by police, the same ones who had arrested, tortured, and disappeared their fellow Koreans during the Japanese occupation. As Reed, though he had been a member of the anti-Japanese resistance, sided with the U.S., finding keeping the brutal and effective Japanese police system in place to be the most efficacious for maintaining order. Some of the local Reed-affiliated thugs taunted Young Man's mother, calling her a red slut. Swept up into Reed's secret prisons were various students, doctors, workers, and even an illiterate housewife who went to a rally where, even though she couldn't read the signs declaring the 27-point program, which included suffrage, freedom of the press and religion, access to food, the right of every Korean, she only saw that they were giving out bags of rice to the hungry.
Stalin similarly came in with troops and in 1948 declared the North the Democratic People's Republic of Korea. The Taegukgi flag of a unified Korea, marked by the spinning hexagrams for earth, water, fire, and heaven, was replaced with a martial flag with the red star and stripes. This was years before the summer of 1950, when that war, which Koreans came to call 625 for its date, it was not the Korean War any more than Americans would call 9/11 the American War. This North-South conflict, which had never existed in Korea among Koreans, exploded at the 30th parallel on 625 and changed them all forever.
Marie, that was amazing, and it's nice to know that even if satire said, irony is not. that we're going to get back to talking to you and to talking to these ladies about small towns. But first, break. Not a real break, but a break. I wanted to take a moment to talk a little bit about the fellowship that is being presented tonight. We started presenting this fellowship in 2010, and we are very lucky to have Abby Scher with us, who is going to be handing over the tiara, as it were. Abby Scher is a performer who's worked on essay anthologies Modern Love and Behind the Bedroom Door, as well as the Times, the Los Angeles, Jane L. Heed, and Red Bull. Her latest collection is called Breaking Free, Two Stories of Girls Who Escaped Modern Slavery. She's also the author of the novel, of the memoir, Amen, 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 and the young adult novel, Kissing Snowflakes. She has written and performed for Second City in Chicago and the Upright Citizens Brigade and Magnet Theater in New York. She lives in New Jersey with her husband and daughter, and she was our very first fellow in 2010-2011. She was
Parentis Fellow. I absolutely loved the storyteller. You're a natural storyteller, so an appropriate title. And while your nonfiction is wonderful and important, especially these days, I'm excited to read more fiction from you too. How lucky we are that we get to write. I wonder about non-writers and what they do with the things they have. How do they process life? How can they not capture the poetry of our lives, both the beauty and the horror? Being a writer feels like being in the very best kind of sisterhood. Being vulnerable is not only accepted, but is a plus in our field of work. We parents get to meld that while we are also creating the stories for our children. Melda and her team at Pen Parentis are so generous in so many ways. They've been the best cheerleader for me this past year, a year that was actually quite difficult for me. Melda's energy and spirit could power me alone. I am so grateful to pass the baton as I was to accept the baton from Meg Pillow, who I've become friends with and probably would not have were it not for Pen Parentis. Welcome to the club. Can't wait to meet you. Now go put your incredible voice out there even more. Jen.
Anjali Vaidya to the stage to receive her.
I would love it if you would.
Yeah.
Why? I have nothing on me that is going to set off an alarm yet. And dropping things.
Am I?
Children had walked a long way since morning without encountering another human voice. The boy stopped and pointed. "Do you see that?" he asked. The girl, Tara, paused with narrowed eyes. "What is that bird?" she asked. A white egret had just landed at the water's edge. It wasn't a bird. Tara looked again as the bird nosed its feathers. "It's just an egret, Tesla. What did you think it was?" Tara resumed walking, stepping across the skeleton of a sea creature. She was trying very hard not to think beyond the present moment. She was trying to lose her thoughts in the rhythm of walking. "I thought I saw an old man," dressed all in white. Tara glanced up at the egret again, black legs planted in the sand, and for a moment, she saw it too, a man in white cloths that billowed in the wind. "Tesla, we just gotta keep walking," said Tara. "We need to find a place to rest." "You know who I think that was?" asked Tesla. His voice had slowed to a storyteller's cadence, and Tara couldn't help but pause and glance back. "Who?" she asked. "The king," he said, "from Papa's story." "I never heard Papa tell a story about a king." "That's because you don't listen, Tara. You gotta pay attention," said Tesla, and Tara smiled. She slowed her pace. "Okay. Story," she said. "Once upon a time," began Tesla, "there was a king who was patient and wise, but he'd never been tested. And it's easy to be a good king when you've never had real problems." Tara had grown very quiet. She sidestepped tree branches and other less identifiable things. A section of wall, the door of a car. For many years, the king had ruled in peace, but one day he learned that a great threat was approaching. A storm was going to wash his kingdom into the sea. "That's not the story," interrupted Tara. "Papa said it was an invading army." "I'm the storyteller," asserted Tesla. "I get to say what happens. Anyway, I thought you didn't remember. Just tell the story." "So there's a storm approaching, and the king goes to the holy men and asks them what to do. They say make a sacrifice, so he slaughters chickens and goats and has a feast for his subjects. After that, they love him even more than they already did." Tara looked out at the ocean, its absolute calm. Above, not a trace of cloud. But clouds start gathering, and the king seeks out the holy men again. He says, "I made all the right sacrifices. Why is the storm still coming?" And they say, "You have to sacrifice something of great value to you." So the king takes all his gold and silver to the temple. But a storm hits the coast. People are dying. Tara paused, disentangled a plastic doll goes back and finds the holiest of holy men, and the king says, I've given everything I had. What more can the gods want? And the holiest of holy men, he says, you have to give something you cannot live without. The king doesn't know what to do. Finally, he's in a boat fleeing the city and sees a child caught in the undertow. Without a thought, the king jumps in and gets the child to safety. But then he's pulled under. The king dies. And just like that, the rain stops. The wind breaks. Tara had stopped walking. She sat in the sand. She wasn't sure. The gods were happy with the king's sacrifice, so they brought him back to life, but changed. He could live forever as a bird, guarding the shores of his beloved land. Tara took a deep breath, seated on the sand. It's not how Papa told that story, she said. The two children watched the waves come in and out, each time depositing more debris onto the darkened sands. I guess I make the stories now.
So we're very, very pleased to have you as our fellow. Anjali was born in Washington, is that right? Born in Washington, 20 years in Bangalore, and now lives in San Diego. So she flew out from San Diego. Yeah, is that right? And you can sit, you don't have to sit. I can tell that you're not thrilled. She is a writer of environmental nonfiction. She's a scientist. And after moving to San Diego, she was telling me that she had a baby, and found out about Penn Parentis from a sister-in-law who worked in New York as an editor and who had recently stopped working, moving